explain that this paper is co-authored. It's been sort of through a number of iterations and sat on the shelf for a while. And Bob's part of the paper, you won't be surprised to hear, is focuses on the deficiencies of mental health professionals as experts in custody proceedings. And so I will refer all questions about that to him. Yeah, all the difficult questions to you, Bob. Well, when Bob Mnookin did his work deconstructing the best interest standard, he ultimately concluded that in disputes between parents, maybe the best interest standard is the best that we can do, despite its vast indeterminacy and all of the problems that it presents. Many other scholars, as you know, have piled on and have elaborated on critiques of the best interest standard. And there are and have emerged since 1975 two alternative rules that have been promoted by advocates and scholars, but have gotten very little traction as replacements for the best interest standard. One of these is a joint custody presumption, a presumption favoring basically equal time for both parents and equal decision-making authority. And the other is a rule focusing on past parental care. The primary caretaker preference was the early version, and the ALI approximation standard is what I would call the updated, improved form of the primary caretaker preference. And so our interest is in why the best interest standard has persisted so doggedly as the dominant decision rule over these 40 plus years since it became the principal custody standard, despite what everyone acknowledges are really very, very severe deficiencies. And as you might imagine, I have a particular interest in this, since I think I have proposed an alternative, which is so much better, and I can't understand why legislatures have not embraced my proposal, or the ALI's proposal. So I think that we identify two sources of entrenchment that I think go some distance, at least, to explaining why the best interest standard has persisted. The first is a kind of political economy story that there has been a gender war between advocates for mothers and fathers that has played out in different ways in legislatures and courts, basically since the 1980s. So in legislatures, the main battles have been over a joint custody presumption. Fathers groups have been really dissatisfied with the best interest of the child standard, which they view as favoring mothers, and have lobbied very hard for a legal presumption favoring joint physical custody, and have come back time and again in many states to push for such a legal rule to replace or embody the best interest standard. But they have been opposed by advocates for mothers and judges and attorneys groups. And although a few states have adopted a joint custody presumption, and I just learned from Nancy that D.C. also has one, but in terms of the kind of rule that fathers groups have been pushing for, very few states have adopted a presumption favoring equal sharing of time between the parents, even though the norm of shared parenting and the importance of the continued relationship between the both parents and the child has become very, very important, as Jana points out in her paper. So this battle has persisted in legislatures. Meanwhile, I'm trying to make this an exciting, you know, like this is gender battle. Meanwhile, advocates for mothers and fathers have basically fought over the content of the best interest standard, with each group advocating for factors that trump other considerations in applying the standard. And so these efforts have been somewhat more successful, quite a bit more successful than the effort to replace the best interest standard. So mothers groups, as you know very well, along with law enforcement organizations, have lobbied for laws disfavoring the parent who has engaged in acts of family violence, and most states have adopted a domestic violence presumption. Fathers groups basically responded to this by promoting parental alienation as a key factor in resolving custody disputes. And beginning in the late 80s, fathers groups and mental health professionals have really pushed the importance of parental alienation, and very, very successfully, as an important factor, not as a presumption, but as a factor that can trump other considerations under the standard. So both of these factors represent important policy goals in custody law, and both offer the potential to resolve a subset of cases under the best interest standard in a way that might bring determinacy to those cases to which they are irrelevant. So that seems like progress, but the impact of the domestic violence presumption and of the importance of parental alienation has really not been, I would say, completely positive, in part because both of these factors are difficult for courts to evaluate. Domestic violence, because it's often based on private information, and parental alienation for that reason, but also because the source of alienation and its impact on children's welfare is completely unclear. And so partly for this reason, and partly because these factors carry so much weight in the custody determination, I think parties have an incentive to make marginal claims. If evidence of domestic violence and alienation can determine the outcome of a custody dispute under an otherwise indeterminate standard, it's not surprising, and there's quite a bit of evidence of this, that lawyers would like to bring credible claims and are pretty focused on doing that. And so these claims, domestic violence and alienation, have become ubiquitous. There are estimates that 70 to 80% of adjudicated custody disputes involve some kind of domestic violence claim, and the numbers are not as high for alienation, but they're very, very high indeed. And I, in the paper, we explore some of the costs of this development, including that judges are likely to get cynical about domestic violence claims and alienation claims in ways that could hurt legitimate claimants. And so I think I'm not going to say much about, it's almost 10 minutes, about the role of mental health professionals, but there is a lot of evidence and that we develop in the paper that judges rely on mental health professionals and on their input in custody cases to basically solve the problems created by this indeterminate standard, to assess party credibility, to get private information, and basically to advise the judges of what the right outcome should be, what's the best arrangement for this child. And when they do this, they are asking mental health professionals to go beyond their expertise because they don't have the expertise to give these opinions. And so I think I'm going to stop there. We have some suggestions. Adopt the approximation standard is one. Mediation is another. But also to apply to custody proceedings the screen on scientific evidence that applies to virtually all other legal proceedings, but not to custody proceedings, would go a long way to exclude this the evidence that expert testimony that I think is not useful and that masks the indeterminacy of the standard.
Thanks, Buffy, and thanks to Bob for this was really the inaugural paper of the symposium and kind of what got us thinking about doing the whole project to begin with. I'm going to try to make a few comments without presenting my own paper. This is the biggest challenge for me here. The paper really fills a very significant void in the literature. We've all been wondering for years why alternatives to the best interest standard haven't been even really sought in the legal system, much as academics have been crying out for them. And I think the account that Buffy and Bob give is as plausible as anyone that I've heard. On joint custody, one of the things we noticed in doing the research for the ALI project, you know, those long pages and pages of notes, was that the joint custody is such an appealing alternative, such an appealing concept, until you get to applying it in just so many cases in which it doesn't apply. Courts and legislatures have really shown they all want in on it in some way or another, but generally speaking, what they give with one hand, thou shalt have joint custody, they take away by how they define it or how you overcome the presumption or whatever. So much so that Buffy and I actually have quite a different in our count about which are the joint custody states. The strongest state is probably Florida. It might be D.C., but I think it's Florida. You have to order joint custody unless there's detriment to the child of ordering joint custody. But then joint custody doesn't mean 50-50 share. So it's like we'll call it what will make people happy, but we're not actually ordering it. And every story, every joint custody story is some variant of that. So some of us think that past caretaking is the answer, and here I feel like we should go no further in this symposium without explaining why I use past caretaking and approximation interchangeably. This whole ALI proposal was obviously built on Buffy's work in 1992, where she conceptualized the approximation standard. When we began debates in this at the ALI, people didn't like approximation because it didn't tell you what was being approximated, and they wanted to key in more definitely on the substantive factor, which was past caretaking. You really kind of need them both to get the idea of what this is all about, which is why using them interchangeably might be as good as any other. But that just to explain, there may be some differences around the edges in terms of what Buffy and I mean by this standard. I don't think any of them are very significant. I will say, just not to comment on what Buffy has just said or her paper, but what came up a little bit earlier, the ALI only recognizes relationships built on past custody which meet the pretty strict definition of de facto parent. So the biggest struggle in the ALI was not sort of defeating best interests, since everyone who studies this for a little while understands its deficiencies, but was beating the grandparent visitation lobby, of which was very heavily represented, as you can imagine, in the ALI. So, and they all knew how important grandparents are. So the ALI only recognizes relationships that meet the definition of de facto parent, and then there is some, and I think Emily has critiqued this in other work, there is a priority on the legal parents over de facto parents in certain situations, but generally you have to get to be a parent, to have any recognition at all, you have to be what was in Bob's article referred to as psychological parent. It's a determinate standard, as you can imagine, and it absolutely requires a live-in relationship for a very significant period of time. Okay, that's a detour. Back to Buffy's paper. She refers. So there's one thing she said that I really object to, actually two things. They're the same point, though. You just referred to the approximation standard as an update on primary caretaker. And then in the paper, you refer to the approximation standard as a compromise. Okay, the second maybe is just a matter of some semantics, but we really didn't see, maybe the marketing has taken over my, we marketed this at least, and I think legitimately, as taking the best of both the joint custody and the primary caretaker. You look and you see, you look at the family. Is there primary caretaking going on here, or is there shared care, parenting going on here? And of course, there's a lot of space in between. And that's what the presumption is. The presumption is whatever you, roughly speaking, that's where the approximation comes in, roughly speaking, what did you do before? So I think it's a political mistake, speaking of politics, to see this as a revision of primary caretaker. In fact, that's one of the criticisms made, that it's just primary caretaker all over again. So I just want to, that's the only place that where emotion will rise in my voice, because this was such a hard-fought battle in terms of how you conceptualized it in the ALI itself. To compromise, similarly, you know, I think it's taking the best of both and not really compromising anything of great value in either of the two alternatives. Okay, let's see. I love, you didn't really refer to it, Buffy, just now, but I love the way you set up domestic violence as a factor to be raised in parental alienation, and saw that when we talk about the lack of science, this is not symmetric. Domestic violence is a lot of real good science. The domestic violence is harmful, and the parental alienation syndrome was basically made up. And so the fact that advocates have tried to put this in as a kind of balanced, well, she did that, but he did that, or vice versa, to point out that the science is not symmetric in terms of the validity of these phenomena, I think is a really crucial contribution. The one other point I want to make is you argue for clear and convincing evidence in domestic violence charges. I have no empirical data here any more than I did for my own paper, which we'll be talking about this afternoon, in terms of systematic collection of evidence. But my sense from reading hundreds of cases in the last few months is that domestic violence is not easily found by courts, and that I question whether or not we need a clear and convincing evidence to sift out the all too close cases or the illegitimate cases. I think maybe what's happened here, which worries me a little bit, is that it's actually all 50 states have some provisions in their custody, take some note in their custody cases with respect to domestic violence. Sometimes it's in the case law, not in the statute, but every state has some decision along these areas. Many states, and including the ALI, what we proposed, the presumption working against a parent who has been had a charge substantiated of family violence is so strong that courts don't want to find it. So what I see, again, non-scientifically reading, and this was an incidental issue and I wasn't counting while I was reading, but what I find is courts are saying, well, yeah, there was a little bit of slapping around, but this is not what the legislature had in mind to trigger such a strong presumption. And so, you know, maybe we need to relook at that nice determinant standard of domestic violence in the context of the presumptions that we're using in custody cases. One thing I'd like to discuss, if not here, then this afternoon or at some point, is since there's, I don't know if unanimity, that's probably too strong a word, but fairly, seems to be an assumption taken for granted so far in this conference that that we need something else besides best interests. Where is it going to come from? And it's sort of, it would be sad if it all depends on the academics, given we've been, you know, talking for decades and not making too much progress. So what will be the politics of what would the politics of success here look like? Where would it come from? And what might we do to accelerate that? So let's switch paces and you can manage the questions.
Thanks, Kate. I've been talking about this paper with Kate for quite a while, so we've had a lot of communications. One thing that I thought was interesting in your paper was the evidence that you found that that courts and legislatures are not favorable to joint custody when there hasn't been a major contribution to care on the both caretaking on the part of both parents, and I think that could in part be a part of the resistance to a joint custody presumption. But I think we should be clear that is exactly what fathers' groups want. Because currently, mothers do a larger share of childcare. I think Bob has found that the evidence suggests now it's about one-third of childcare, which would suggest that that under approximation there would be a two-thirds. One-third division, and that's not what fathers want because that the fathers' groups want an equal division. Now, the reason I call, and I will certainly be more sensitive to the politics of this, but the reason I call the approximation standard an update on the primary caretaker preference is that, like primary caretaker, it focuses pretty narrowly on past caretaking. Obviously, it's quite different in terms of the of allocating the custody between parents, and it does accommodate both the joint custody and primary caretaker. Depending on the child's circumstances, and I think that's one of the great benefits of it. But it is in its focus in terms of what's important. It is quite similar to the primary caretaker preference. It's interesting because I think it is assumed that, and I think it's probably true, that fathers' groups would be opposed to approximation. It hasn't really been offered much in the political arena, so it's surprising. I mean, I was hoping that you might have found some states where approximation was almost adopted, but it is surprising to me that that women's groups have not pushed approximation, which is a more determinate rule that is favorable to mothers, and that also has the endorsement of this august ALI. And I can't help but conclude, and I sort of speculate about this in the paper as to why women's groups in general, or mothers advocates in general, have not been active in promoting their own favored rule, that they're not that unhappy with the best interest standard. And in fact, when I was publishing the article in the early 90s in the California Law Review, the editor who was assigned to the article was a woman who was pretty offended by the argument, because she thought it would be harmful to mothers, which I thought was pretty interesting, and it actually was taken away from her. Howard Shalansky ended up being my editor, because the initial editor was not happy with the possible outcome under the best interest standard. We do make clear in the paper that domestic violence presumption has scientific support, whereas the parental alienation is based on bogus science. I think there is a problem with the role of mental health experts in supporting domestic violence claims, and that is that mental health expertise in counseling and helping victims of domestic violence does not extend to credibility assessments. And that is basically what they're testifying about in custody cases, that this is a believable claim, and this person was the subject of domestic violence on the basis of her statements. So just finally, and I want to open up, but finally, how is reform actually going to come? Who knows if it ever will, but what I could see happening is that as the research suggests, that fathers are taking an increasing role in caring for their children, and as fathers' share of caretaking gets closer to that of mothers, that this standard may become more palatable and perhaps less the subject of controversy, and the hope is that other groups whose interests are not fathers or mothers but children might sort of jump into the fray and promote legal reform. So that's the optimistic view.
You're going to let the practice come to the law rather than the law.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, Nancy.
So I have a couple of things. I really, really like this paper. I love stuff about the mental health professionals. I have to say something about the violence, the domestic violence piece. I understand your argument completely, and I would never say that there are no false claims of domestic violence, or along the lines you develop, I think very well, a sort of overplaying of one-time events in a way that isn't really about the ongoing relationships in the family.
Mm-hmm.
But there is so much domestic violence, and I am really worried that the way you want it treated will miss too much that really happens. I am even after all these years, continually shocked by how violent men can be in families. And I just was really worried, mm-hmm. reading your paper, that the requirements you put on it were going to miss too many instances, and the ones they were going to miss were the ones where the perpetrator is able to present the most, the most positive view of himself in court and in the public, the situations of men who look to the outside world like they are such wonderful husbands and fathers, and, you know, at home it's a different story. I don't know, I don't have a specific answer, but it was the biggest concern I had in the way you wanted to set it up.
And it's certainly something that we struggled with, because clearly, you know, if we had an omniscient judge who could detect real cases of domestic violence and sort of exclude marginal claims, that would be wonderful. And we think that the presumption has had a beneficial effect. What worries me is the similarity between the sort of popularity, if you will, of domestic violence allegations, and that I say that, you know, but they're everywhere in custody disputes. The similarity between that and child sexual abuse claims in the 90s. And those claims were also supported by mental health expertise, mental health experts testifying. And there's quite a bit of evidence that judges got pretty skeptical about child sexual abuse claims. And as Claire suggested earlier, child maltreatment rates have gone down in large part because sexual abuse allegations have gone down. Well, why did that happen? I think that the claims are not being brought as much in custody cases, and in part because judges don't value them or don't weigh them very credibly. So I'm very sympathetic. I mean, I actually changed my thinking about this in response to a comment of Max's the paper. I actually initially had thought that maybe there should be corroborating evidence of domestic violence, and then decided that would exclude too many legitimate claims. So it's a hard question.
I just want to push back briefly, because okay. I know other people. So I think the drop, I think the danger of the friendly parent provisions in the statutes are even greater than what you put in your paper, and that what it is to raise an allegation that you can't completely follow through on to the judge's satisfaction is to be branded the unfriendly parent and to lose custody. And I think for child sexual abuse situations, those are even harder to prove than domestic violence against the mother. I mean, when I was in practice, I'll never forget a conversation with a mother about what her husband was doing to her child, which essentially involved masturbating in bed with the 3-year-old daughter. And so no marks. I mean, it was a completely unprovable thing. And so what do I have to say to her? You can try to go to court and make this case against your husband, but you have no corroboration, you can't get corroboration, and you risk, if it looks like you're not believed, he's going to get custody of the kid. So of course she doesn't make the claim in court, because the stakes are so high. And I still do understand and sympathize with the fact that some people are going to make up claims that aren't true. I mean, I don't think my argument has to rest upon a belief that, you know, every mother is virtuous and doesn't elaborate or you know, fictionalize something. Yeah. But I'm afraid that the way you want to make it difficult goes too far.
Well, you're not the first one to have that reaction. Yes, Emily.
So one of the last things you said, sort of the optimistic story, is that men will be more and more involved in parenting, and so the approximation standard will basically give them more what they're asking for anyways, or some version of that. I just wanted to sort of say, well, if we think that joint custody is often the wrong way to go, joint physical custody, it isn't going to get better just because they've had a different relationship while the marriage is intact. What I would say is that, you know, my resistance, I'm not completely on board with the approximation standard, is that how we want people to be able to order their lives when they're together you know, there's so many reasons that we wouldn't want that to be the same. We might not, you know, so in classically, you know, families work out, they may both want to spend as much time as possible with the kids, but somebody needs to make money, or maybe they both want to advance their careers, but someone needs to raise the kids, whatever. It's sort of, you work out accommodations that are hard enough to achieve when you're really in love and getting along, but you achieve them because you get some kind of value out of that coordination. But it isn't at all clear that you would, that that's how you would order things as two separate households, nor is it clear that that's a very good indication of what would be good for the child, because you're not collaborating anymore, or a sort of a happy sharing once you don't have that collaboration. And so that's a kind of general question about the approximation standard, that, and I thought your optimistic futures sort of really pressed that question, because mm-hmm. it seems like the difference between really involved parents living together and figuring out how to make it work versus two separate households where someone's moving around, whether the child's moving back and forth or the parents are moving in and out of houses, and all that does just that those are not approximately the same, and let alone the emotional piece that changes so much in the transaction, increased transaction cost with worse ability to handle the transactions. But I wonder, sort of circling back to some questions that were asked, and maybe this is also connected with thinking about Bob's separate piece, is that, you know, maybe there's more of a role for agreement, including agreement at the front end, right? So if people go into an arrangement that is pretty imbalanced in terms of how much time is being spent at home or with children versus how much time in the you know, paid labor force, you know, if there's an understanding from the beginning about how much this is, you know,
the beginning of the marriage, or
or when you have kids or whatever, but you know, something where you're sort of asked to articulate how much this is about an arrangement that is, you know, because we're together in this collaborative, we're all sacrificing something and anticipating, you know, it's another kind of prenup, but the question is whether there's room with an anticipation of an approximation standard like decision at the back end, is there room for, should we be at all optimistic about the potential for front end assessment of, you know, sort of what, how much does this actually correlate with some abstracted sense of how we're going or something? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, I think that I came to the conclusion that this was the best custody rule by comparing it to what the alternatives might be. So it really is a kind of compared to what analysis. That comparison that we live with is to the best interest standard. So is looking at who's been taking care of the child and in what in sort of what portion of care, a better or worse basis for future relationships than any number of qualitative factors that are impossible to assess and subject to the biases of judges. And I guess, I mean, my conclusion is I can't think of anything else that would be a better basis for going forward if the parties can't agree. And it seems to me, and this may be sort of, you know, wishful thinking perhaps, but if parents have really fully shared care of their children during their relationship, then they're used to that sharing. And it's not the situation, which is, I think, what mothers resent so much now when joint custody is ordered, that the father is getting a windfall. What did he ever do for the children when they lived together, and now he has equal custody? You wouldn't have that reaction in the same under the approximation standard, and at least, hopefully, both parents would recognize to some extent the fairness of the custody arrangement and would accept it if it were based on their past pattern of care. Well, your suggestion about a couple sort of agreeing at the front end to what their allocation of child care would be, and then as the basis for a custody arrangement when they get divorced is sort of what Bob Scott and I argued for in our article, Marriage as Relational Contract. And we concluded that at least in a hypothetical bargain situation, they would agree to approximation as the way to resolve disputes in the future. So, you know, it's an interesting thought. Yeah. Yeah, Bob.
I want to just ask a question where you could help me understand the relationship between friendly parent provisions, mm-hmm. on the one hand, and a parental alienation. I believe, too, that parental alienation syndrome is bogus science. I guess the question I have is, to what extent in the case law, if there's a powerful demonstration that the child, that parental alienation doesn't go to the alienation of the two parents to each other.
No.
Although there may be a lot of hostility. Mm-hmm. It's the alienation of a child to one of the parents, mm-hmm. all right? And I guess the question is, under the best interest standard, one would a priori think that would be hugely relevant if a child, particularly an older child, says, I don't get along with my father at all. I don't want to be with my father. Let's say it's a 9-year-old and it's not, or a 6-year-old, but it's not a 14-year-old, where under the law of some states it could really make a big difference. I gather what you're saying is, well, the parental alienation syndrome is raised as a defense, that where the father uses the evidence of the child's alienation from him as the fault of the mother, mm-hmm. because she's turned the child against me, and that somehow this is resulting in judges awarding custody to fathers. Now, I have a question. Is this really happening? And I'm sure in the custody world, some things, or whatever you can imagine, is sometimes happening. But, you know, given that, in fact, even with a friendly parent, you know, presumption, in a circumstance where there's powerful evidence that presently the kid really is alienated from this parent, are courts then awarding the father custody under best interest? I mean, it just seems so preposterous to me that...
Yes. You would be yes is the answer. Okay. And also awarding joint custody as the only way that the father is going to have a relationship with the child is if he has joint custody. So there are many opinions, and you know, I'm not saying that, you know, 50% of adjudicated custody disputes result in an award of custody to the alienated parent, but the threat of that outcome is quite powerful to mothers, and it certainly if you read the appellate cases, it certainly does happen. And one reason that alienation has taken on so much importance is that mental health professionals, even those who don't believe in the syndrome baloney, think this is incredibly important. I mean, there are some surveys that mental health professionals rank alienation as the number two factor after, you know, the parent is a total alcoholic, as it being important to custody.
Wait a second, though. I want to be clear. They view... Let me differentiate two things.
No, it's the parent creating the alienation. It's a brain.
It's not that the reality that a child wants to have no relationship.
But what you do see is courts inferring that the parent must be the source of the alienation.
And certainly fathers arguing that, or parents who are alienated arguing that the source of the alienation is the other parent who's poisoning the child's mind against the parent. Yeah, Jen.
I just think this shows how powerful the notion is that it is in children's best interest following divorce to have these close and continuing relationships with both parents. And that's now so deeply ingrained that the idea that one parent would thwart that is equivalent to thinking that that parent is not concerned with acting contrary to the best interest.
That's right.
And it's a great illustration of what I think is a real, you know, shift, you know, which I write about, but where I think what was so illuminating about, for me, about your paper is the role that the mental health profession has really, the leading role that I think it played in that shift, and which, they may be right, but we almost don't realize how completely kind of so many things are now kind of based on that bedrock assumption.
Totally.
That this is.
And I think what's interesting is that what is, in the abstract, a very benign policy that it's good for children to continue to have a relationship with both parents has become the basis of this kind of claim, which basically is not hard, it's not that many steps from the policy to the parents' claim that I can't have a relationship with a close relationship with my child because his other parent is poisoning his mind against me, and that's where the action has been. That's where the law has developed, and you know, you get these legislative history statements of, you know, jolly legislators saying, well, this will be great, it'll encourage the parents to get along and not fight over custody, and won't that be wonderful? And to some extent it may have that influence with parents who can resolve their disputes out of court, which is most parents. But for those who can't get along, it has become a weapon to be used against the other parent. Yeah, Max.
Just to put a point on both of that, there is a presumption of joint custody bill that is moving through our state senate, which is, I don't know how many of them are. Yeah, you've seen it, Suzanne, which is something. But I mean, it does. I mean, it brings up just this issue, and the relevant findings sought to be adopted is that it is in the best interest of the child and consistent with current research that the child have the maximum possible relationship with both parents. And just setting it up as here are the experts who have said this is in the interest of children, and anybody who opposes that is acting against
it. It's remarkable how embedded that norm has become in both the law and in practice.
And they don't cite
anything, right? I don't think that's what the research shows. Research shows it's in the best interest to have a relationship, not the maximum possible.
Yeah, Bob.
Just a couple of observations more than questions, I guess, is just one, listening to you talk, and we're all well aware of this, but how quickly, this happens in mediation all the time. Supposedly we're talking about what's in the best interest of kids, and very quickly we're talking about mother's rights versus father's rights, and kids get completely lost in all of this. And it just happens over and over again in individual families and in policy discussions and sort of observation. Another observation is really about that, as much as I would like to believe otherwise, and as much as some people believe otherwise, you know, neither judges nor mental health professionals are omniscient, you know, and I'm not able to, some psychologists think they can and will testify that they can, but I didn't take that class in omniscience. And so I have a hard time knowing what's best for kids, particularly, I always go back to Bob's original paper, when you can't define what best is to begin with, how can I possibly know what best is? Which was come to me, and I'll say a little bit about it later today, is that expert testimony in these cases, which is just, the bar is so low compared to expert testimony in other areas, isn't about expert testimony. To me, it's about arbitration. It's about the judges don't know what to do, so put the mental health professional in the position of making decisions. And then the last observation, just with your original question about, you know, why people don't embrace this, and I actually had the same thought there, is that, you know, our minds, and I really do think it's our minds, go to the case rather than to science, to the average. So when Claire's talking about our minds go to that, you know, we, so, you know, social workers don't want to send this kid back home when this might end up being a newspaper headline, right? Because in our policy is driven by that extreme case. Every time I bring up the approximation rule, which is a lot, as you know, people will say to me, oh, but what about that poor dad who the divorce makes him realize that he's made a huge mistake? And we want to make the exception for the case. Or even more generally, in Chicago in January, the Association of Family and Conciliation Courts pulled together about 40 experts to come to a consensus on custody law, judges, lawyers, one legal academic. And the consensus seems to be, despite, it's not my opinion, is that there shouldn't be any rules. Like, you know, we best interest vague has to
trust the judges.
Yeah, exactly. Because there's always going to be an exception to the rules, and you can't see the problems with not having rules. You know, those invisible cases, not seeing the problems of overreaching in child protective services, you know, because it's driven by that extreme case. And it's just
there's no question that one would have to acknowledge that any more determinate rule is not going to get every case right. But when you weigh sort of relative costs and benefits of a completely indeterminate rule, it seems to me that it's pretty clear that it would be better to have a determinate rule. Do you think we need to stop, or should, yeah? Is she going to attack me again?
Now you should just go ahead and.
No. So I want to explore. I love that you are trying to identify why it is that domestic violence advocates have been successful in getting legislation, but that, you know, mothers groups more broadly have not pushed back mm-hmm. against presumptive joint custody with something like the approximation standard, or perhaps a primary caretaker standard. And I have been puzzled about this for decades now. And I found myself not sold on your conclusion, which I'm not sure you're sold on either, that it's because mothers think they're doing fine under best interest and so they don't need to change it. I just have some suspicion there's something else at work, that maybe domestic violence is the easiest hat to lay anything on because everyone agrees it's bad.
Yeah.
And plus there's funding for domestic violence work through the Violence Against Women Act and other sources. So it's the only place the women's movement actually has a funded infrastructure of people
right.
who specifically look at that. I also wonder if they just think it's politically unpalatable and it'll make them look worse, and so they won't get anything. But all I'm saying is I think it's a great question, mm-hmm. and I'm dying to know the answer. And if I could just send you back to do, I don't know, a few more months of analysis and research to see if you could come up with something beyond what your mm-hmm. conclusion
well,
was.
Just one comment about that. I spent a lot of time on fathers groups' websites,
right.
and on NOW's website and other, the anger that fathers groups have over custody and over how fathers are screwed under the best interest standard is really motivating these groups. I just don't see that kind of outrage among mothers groups. And in fact, mothers groups, when they oppose joint custody, are aligning with judges in upholding the best interest of the child standard. And so, I mean, NOW has this statement on its website that it favors the primary caretaker preference. It hasn't really even considered approximation, but it's like on page 3 somewhere. It's not a big issue. And I think it is in part, they're very focused on fighting joint custody and very focused on domestic violence. And that's, you know, that's the best I can do to explain this quiescence. Yeah. Yeah.
And just real briefly, just on the fathers groups, and we this is a pretty like-minded group. But if there are places in people, if we said, oh, that alienation science is a bunch of bunk, which I completely believe, and we're all kind of nodding our heads, they said, we would be fried, literally. I mean, that would create a lot of anger. What do you mean it doesn't exist? Of course it exists, and tell you about the. So there's a lot of strength, a lot of anger, a lot of belief out there.
Yes.
And don't you think that it might be the resistance to the approximation rule might be just that women's groups feel like we were burned with this innocuous shared parenting, they should have a relationship with both, and look how that turned. Hmm. You know, that's now it's morphed into, well, it was shared parenting, and then it became equal parenting. And,
maybe.
And the friendly
I think part
parent.
Of it, too, is that there's reason for mothers' groups to be skeptical about judicial fact-finding. So, I mean, how many cases do we have where even under the primary caretaker standard, a man who did something other than take out the garbage was considered
saint, saintly
yeah.
father.
So I think, so I don't, it's hard, the problem with that observation is it's hard to know what it proves, because they should be worried, obviously, about best interest. But there's something about best interests, well, children belong with their mother. We're living with, mothers groups are benefiting from that stereotype. And maybe just
the feeling responsible.
Yeah, you know, for very bad example.
Keeping
well, we've partly done yes. my we've
yeah.
partly done my
oh well.
So I think
Bruce
and Kim, who's just joined us. Good to have you here. Kim's not well, but I'm just going to keep her distance.
Right.
And
I won't touch you.